comprehensive summaries of such a perennial philosophy. Please go ahead. So with respect to leadership, we all talk about, people talk about, you know, fire. It's a fire of leadership. So this is Bob Nelson saying, you get the best effort from others, not by lighting a fire beneath them, but by building a fire within. So we can push people. Leaders are people who don't just do things, but they have to get things done from others. And one way to get things done from others is by pushing them. There's a carrot and stick policy. But if people can be inspired from within, if there's a fire lit within them, then they take responsibility for what they are doing. And then they do much more than what they would do otherwise. Yeah? The Bhagavad Gita talks about lighting the fire within. And one of the messages of the Bhagavad Gita is that, we see in the example of Krishna with the speaker itself, leadership is not a matter of designation. It's a matter of disposition. There can be people who are appointed as leaders. They get the designation. But if they do not have the disposition of wanting to bring out the best from within their subordinates, then often they end up underusing or even abusing the resources that are provided to them. So leadership is essentially, it's a matter of designation. It's not a matter of designation. Although different people may be positioned as leaders in different places of society, but every one of us at one level is a leader. And anyone who takes up the disposition of leadership has the opportunity to make constructive contributions. John Maxwell is a leadership consultant, and when he says that are leaders born or made, that's a perennial question that comes up. So he says that every one of us is ultimately a leader. Sociologists tell us that even the most introverted individual will influence 10,000 other people during his or her lifetime. So even if we have no post, we have no nature of mixing too much with people, but still just by observing us, people are learning. So every one of us is by default in a small or great circle leader. What then to speak of people who are actually in leadership positions? So not about him. We are all leaders, and not just at the personal level. At a personal level we are leaders, but at a social level also many of us are leaders. Now, what is the Bhagavad Gita's take on leadership? Go ahead. So the Gita is a conversation between leaders. The Gita is among the world's many wisdom literature that are there. The Gita is probably having the most dramatic setting. You know, war is about to take place, armies are assembled, the elephants are trumpeting, the horses are neighing, the conches are blown, the horse hooves are thudding, the dust clouds are billowing, and there is tension and passion in the atmosphere at that time. And, you know, expert teachers use experiential learning. Now, take the students to the field and let them learn from the experience. But Krishna, he is the consummate teacher. He transforms a battlefield into a classroom. He transforms a battlefield into a classroom, and by his presence and presentation, he raises the student Arjuna's level of consciousness to a level far beyond the battle that is going on outside. In fact, the outer battle is the smaller distraction that Krishna as a teacher has to overcome. That there is a bigger battle going on in Arjuna's mind. In the Bhagavad Gita, we just go by its setting. There's a warrior who lost his school before the war and didn't want to fight. And then Krishna made him fight the war. Now that sort of book would not have had much relevance for millennia, for millions of people who have had nothing to do with battle. So the Bhagavad Gita's enduring relevance is because the battlefield is a setting which catches attention. What would philosophy have to do on a battlefield? So similarly, the question may come up, leadership is something we have to do, things in this world. What would spirituality have to do with that? So the Gita uses the most what people might consider anti-spiritual setting, a setting of war, to demonstrate how spirituality is needed even in such a setting. Arjuna took time out and he needed that time. Because before he could fight the outer war, or he had to win the inner war. The inner war was between his emotion and his reason. The inner war was between his emotions, which made him stray from a challenging duty that was set upon him, and his reason, which was temporarily overpowered. So in that battle, and this is a battle which all of us go through at different times, especially in sports, we say that there are players or there are even teams, we say they choke under pressure. And then they are from a winning situation because their emotions catch hold. They squander the chances. So the battle between emotion and reason is what the Bhagavad Gita addresses in its message. Its essential message is, at the start of the Gita, Arjuna has put down his bow. Visrujasacharam japam shokasam vignamanasaha. In the first chapter, 46th verse, Arjuna, it is described in the Bhagavad Gita that Arjuna has put aside his bow. Now, Arjuna's bow represents the human drive to achieve. For Arjuna as an archer, the bow is a tool with which he is going to achieve. So the bow in general for all of us represents the human drive to achieve, to do justice to our potential, to do good to whatever talents what we have been given, and to make contributions to the world. So this drive to achieve, when we face challenges, adversities and reversals in the outer world, we metaphorically are tempted to put aside our bow. Why take all the trouble? By the end of the Bhagavad Gita, it is the Bhagavad Gita concludes the vision. That is 18.78 states, Yatra Yogeshwara Krishna Yatra Partho Dhanurdharaha. So Partho Dhanurdharaha, Arjuna Dhanurdhara, he has picked up his bow and is ready to fight again. He's ready to take up the call of duty. And what that represents is that the message of the Bhagavad Gita demonstrates the transformational power of spiritual love. There, what Krishna speaks to Arjuna in the Gita enables Arjuna to restore his morale and to raise his bow and again become ready to fight whatever battles life sends our way. So, if we see here, Krishna demonstrates his leadership potential by inspiring a disheartened friend for whom he becomes a mentor. But Krishna is a leader in his own right. If we look at the background, Krishna rose from obscurity and adversity. Just right in his childhood, even before he was born, there was a conspiracy afoot to kill him. And he had to be sequestered away in a pastoral village. And that's where he lived, dodging many dangerous assassins who had sent his way. And then eventually he came back and he overthrew the tyrant who had been persecuting the world at that time. And yet after that, Krishna had the right to become a king, but he chose not to become the king. He had his grandfather Ugrasen be the king. So Krishna put contribution above position. He did the royal responsibilities, but he did not choose the royal designation. Now in a society where often we see that there are leaders who are primarily concerned with what we can get, rather than what we can give. Krishna is an example of doing contribution without seeking the position. So Krishna is a leader in his own way. And then we look at Arjuna. Next slide. So Arjuna is also a leader. He was not by dynasty. He was born in a royal dynasty. And along with that virtuosity, he was a great archer. That is a time when a leader's potential, in different cultures, the leader's capacities are evaluated in different ways. They lived in a martial culture. So martial skills were considered to be one of the prime determiners of the leadership potential of a person. So Arjuna was the topmost archer in a time when there were many celebrated archers. So both by his dynasty and by his virtuosity, by his ability, he was a leader. And when these two leaders
engaged in a conversation. And this conversation which they engaged in was not just armchair chat on a Sunday night after a full meal. That's kind of casual. But when Arjuna and Krishna were discussing, this was a very serious talk. Prichami tvam dharma sammoola chetaha. Arjuna says, what am I asking you? Okay, you see, Arjuna doesn't simply ask Krishna, should I fight or should I not fight? That is the circumstantial question. But the essential question that he has is, how do we know what we should do in our life? Dharma, as was mentioned by Mr. Kathir, that Sanatan Dharma, it is not just about some sectarian designation. Hinduism is as a functional name, okay. We need some name to designate people who have certain beliefs. So Hinduism is fine for that purpose. But if you look at the essential teachings, it is about understanding our own nature. If dharma is anything, it is simply harmonizing with who we are. Dharma is essentially the process of understanding our nature and harmonizing with who we are. So the Bhagavad Gita is when Arjuna asks, Prichami tvam dharma sammoola chetaha. What is it that I should do? So what is my duty? That word duty in English is a pale equivalent of the many rich connotations of dharma. Dharma essentially means not just some duty which some society, some country, some group has imposed upon us. Dharma is the set of activities that helps us return to our nature, that helps us harmonize with who we are. Now it's said that what we are is God's gift to us, and what we become is our gift to God. So what we are, we all have certain talents, certain gifts. Whatever we have, that is God's gift to us. But the way we grow those talents, the contribution that we make through those talents, that is our gift to God. So now, the Bhagavad Gita talks about not just change of perception. That there is, you can talk about seeing a bigger picture. Dr. Kulkarni talked about this. So now there's two things in this. There's a change of perception and there's a change of perspective. So the Bhagavad Gita, change of perception is if there is a glass of water, famous example there. Some people see it as half empty, others see it as half full. So don't see it as half empty, see it as half full. That is a change of perception. Change of perception means we change what we see, or rather change what we focus on. The Bhagavad Gita doesn't just focus on this. It focuses on, don't just change your perception, change your perspective. Perspective means from where we see. Not just what we see, but from where we see. So that means, suppose we are caught in a hurricane and maybe there is some fire broke out somewhere, some water is going somewhere. We'll be in a panicky situation at that time. But if a helicopter comes overhead and air lifts us, now we are still in that area. But now we are not immediately threatened by that circumstance. Why? Because we have been lifted above that situation. So when we look at that same hurricane hit area from above, we are seeing from a different perspective. When we see from a different perspective, not just what we focus on changes, but what we see also changes. We are able to see a much bigger picture. So one of the central threads of the Gita is yoga. Now, yoga nowadays is, here in America, it is mostly about physical postures for improving health. In India, to some extent, yoga has become an exercise for political posturing. Where people are trying to say that yoga is a means to prove India's greatness to the world. Which is fine as far as it goes. Both are okay as far as they go. We can use yoga for good health. And yoga has come from India. So credit can be given to India for that. But the essence of yoga is actually connection. In the
Vedanta, in the Yoga Sutra, Patanjali says that what is yoga? Yoga is chitta vritti nirodha. He says that when the mind, which keeps going external, it stops going externally and turns inwards. That is the essence of yoga. So, when the Bhagavad Gita's teaching about yoga is about turning our consciousness inwards. So when we turn inwards, actually we automatically go upwards. Because our existence is two-dimensional. There is a spiritual side to us and there is a material side to us. Martin Luther King was referred to earlier as a prominent leader. He said that we live in an age of guided missiles and misguided men. We are guided missiles. We have phenomenal technology today for precisely guiding external objects. But unfortunately, we have misguided. So, there are many sobering aspects of this internal misguiding. There are 1 million people who commit suicide every year. This count, 1 million, is more than the total number of people who are killed every year through murders, through violent crimes, through terrorist attacks, through wars, all combined together. That means more than the number of people who are being killed by others are the number of people who are killing themselves. So why is this? Suicide is of course a complex problem. But one common denominator when people start thinking of suicide, taking steps towards this, when they feel that life has no point, that life is a dead end, and whatever I'm trying to achieve in life, it's worthless. It's not going to happen. So what the Bhagavad Gita tells us is that our life has a material side, our life has a spiritual side. When we focus only on the material side, material things are external to us. They're not always in our control. And when those things go out of control, and this happens often in business and in leadership, we prepare a lot for certain plans and projects, and suddenly some contingency comes up, some war breaks out somewhere, some natural calamity happens, the market crash happens. We cannot prepare for anything. So if our whole life is wedded in externals, then when a storm comes externally, we collapse. Not only does the external world collapse, our inner world collapses. But when we understand our spiritual side and understand it not just intellectually, but also experientially by the practice of yoga. So as I said, I talked about airlifting a person above a hurricane danger. So the practice of yoga is a practice that lifts our consciousness upwards from the material level to the spiritual level. So when our consciousness is raised upwards, still we can see the problems. But a spiritualist can be concerned about problems without being disturbed by problems. Spirituality is not about rejecting the world as false, but it is about rejecting being consumed by the world. We know that we are bigger. The Bhagavad Gita's teaching is that we are Atma, which is indestructible. That means we at our core are bigger than any problem that life may send us. And further, when we understand our spiritual identity, we are raised upwards. After we are raised upwards, we can look at that problem with greater calmness. Then the Bhagavad Gita Krishna says in 18.58, Mat chitta sarva durgani, mat prasada tarishyasi, atha chetam ahankara nashroshyasi vinanshyasi. He says, if you become conscious of me, you will pass over all obstacles by my grace. If, however, you act out of ego, not hearing me, you will be lost. So what this means in our context is that when we face challenges in the external world, sometimes we dwell over problems more and more and more. And the more we think of a problem, the problem becomes bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And that worry sucks and saps our mental energy. And in that way, people disempower themselves. So when we say people are misguided, you live in the age of guided man, besides a misguided man. What is that misguiding? What is that thing that misguides? Now that is our own misdirected focus. The more we think of problems, the more those problems often become bigger and bigger. So the Bhagavad Gita is essentially saying over here, don't tell God how big your problems are. Tell your problems how big God is. So if we are conscious of the Supreme Reality, we are conscious of our spiritual side, and if we are conscious of the Supreme Being, as a Supreme Brain, if we connect with Him, then machitaha, that gives us the reassurance that there is something higher which is always there with us. So this airlifting of our consciousness to a higher level of reality is something which is repeatable. Anyone who practices the process of yoga, now there are different processes of yoga. What is recommended in this age is the process of mantra yoga. Mantra, we can envision it as a consciousness elevator. Some of you may have taken a staircase to come up, others may have taken an elevator. Either way, we could come up. So when our consciousness is caught in small things, then if we practice the process of mantra meditation, and practicing the process of mantra meditation is not just uttering the mantra. Uttering the mantra is just the beginning. We utter the mantra so that the mantra creates like a spiritual vibration all around us. And when we seat ourselves in the spiritual vibration, our consciousness gets raised upwards. When our consciousness is raised upwards, Albert Einstein said that problems cannot be solved at the same level of awareness that created those problems. So a few years ago, I was invited at the 50th anniversary of the founding of the United Nations. And the head of the Indian division, she was speaking that the United Nations was started with very benevolent intention, and it is worked by many benevolent workers. And millions of volunteers, billions of dollars have been spent in it. And yet, in almost all the fields where the United Nations has been acting, unfortunately, things have not improved substantially. Whether you talk about war avoidance, whether you talk about elimination of weapons of mass destruction, whether you talk about ecology, things are going on a downward slide. And there can of course be many factors for this. But one factor which is, as I was talking about, was about ethics. Now there is the understanding that we should follow ethics. But why should we follow ethics? If our worldview is primarily materialistic, where we think, where there is no importance given to life's spiritual side, then success means getting more and more and more. Then if I have to get more and more and more, and that is all that there is to success, then why should I let ethics come in the way? Now nobody may say this so bluntly, but underlying it, without a spiritual worldview, now, anything that checks us in gaining more and more, that is an obstacle. So the question was raised about how can we be spiritual, which requires being compassionate, and we live in a competitive world. The Bhagavad Gita analyzes various activities in its framework of three modes. Three modes is sattvaguna, rajaguna, tamaguna. These modes we can envision as subtle forces that shape the interaction between consciousness and things around us. So sattva-guna, rajaguna, tamaguna. It's goodness, passion and ignorance. Sometimes it is translated. I'll just give a couple of examples to illustrate that. And then I will come to the subject of competition and compassion. So suppose people are watching a movie and suddenly a fire breaks out. So now people who are in tamoguna, in the mode of ignorance, they just get petrified. Petrified completely, and the fire will burn and they will not move at all. So there are people who in rajoguna, they are hyperactive. So normally whenever there is something like a fire, they are all stampede towards the exit. And that will create a stampede. That will offer more than the fire injury causing injury, it will stampede and may cause injury.
people in goodness is they are thoughtful. Where is the fire extinguisher? Look at the fire extinguisher and immediately go and go to the fire extinguisher and extinguish the fire. So when now these are frames of mental functioning, the three modes, and we could consider that as if we have a car with different gears. These are three gears for our mental functioning, for the functioning of our mental engine. And so if we put it in another way, is that some people make things happen, some people watch things happen, and some people wonder what happened. So those who make things happen are in sattva guna. Those who watch things happen, oh, this happened, that happened, what should I do about this, what should I do about that, what should I do about it? They're running around doing 100 things. People in raja guna, in passion, are active without being productive. It's doing this, doing that, but not producing results. So that is, the people in tamo guna wonder what's going on, no figuring out. So when there is contemplation and action, that is sattva guna. When there is action without contemplation, that is raja guna. And when there is neither action nor contemplation, this is impulsive response. Now that is more or less tamo guna. So competition can also be in different modes. So all competition is not necessarily undesirable. Now, sometimes competition is the spur that brings out the best within people. So there are in sports also examples of healthy rivalries. Where two players, say for example, tennis is a team sport, so they're an individual sport. The two players, they are rivals, and each of them helps each other to rise to a higher and higher level. So that sort of competition actually helps each of them to become better. And the competition can be very fierce in the arena of the sport. But outside, there is no personal animosity. So that sort of competition is sattvic. It's in the mode of goodness. Where we want to do the best that we can. And yes, in that process, if someone is defeated, our purpose is not defeating that person. Our purpose is doing our best. And we live in a world where competition is unavoidable. But we don't have to make it ugly or destructive. Whereas, so, in the mode of, going to the other extreme, in the mode of ignorance, competition means one just doesn't want to excel. One simply wants to destroy the competition, destroy everyone else. So the idea is if everyone else is destroyed, I will get the whole pie. But what I have done to deserve the pie? Nothing practical. So destructive competition is what is definitely undesirable. And there can also be rajasic competition. In rajasic competition, when in the mode of passion, people are competition. When there is competition, there may not be. We not destroy our rivals, but we make the rivalry into something like an enemy, where we hold personal animosity towards others. So that is something which, if the compass there is, we are spiritual beings, whereas we are living in this material world. In the material world, in the outer world, there's a fundamental economic paradox that there are finite resources. And that's why for those finite resources, there is going to be competition. But when there is goodness, there is an equitable matching of talents with vocations. That means, rather in today's society, often we have an unfair competition where, say, as was mentioned, everybody wants their children to become engineers or doctors. So then, sometimes some students are just not made to be engineers. And then they don't have that mathematical skills or whatever. They are forced to compete with others who have those mathematical skills. Then it's a difficult competition for them. So in sattva guna, we recognize that competitions are inevitable. But rather than imposing one definition of success on everyone, and only if you succeed in this, you are successful. Otherwise, you are not. So we let people be individuals. And develop their own talents and achieve success according to their definitions. So that way, there is competition, but that competition, rather than requiring, there are three levels of competition. There is competition which is artificially created because everyone is pressurized to do the same thing. If everyone is pressurized, you become an engineer, you become a doctor. Then there is unnecessary competition in the medical engineering fields. And many other fields, they don't get talented students. So sometimes there is socio-cultural pressure that increases competition in certain fields. That can be avoided. And then further, if we see there is competition, that is natural, where the competition, rather than being stepping on others' feet, it is more about bringing or expressing oneself the best. So if all of us develop our talents, and if we live in an environment where people are encouraged to be their best rather than the best, that the best is decided by someone else, then in such there is there we compete, rather than competing with others, we compete with ourselves. Then we can always be on the path of self-excellence. So we can be compassionate towards others in intention. In function, depending on timely circumstance, we may have to be competitive. But that compassionate intention comes out even in competition, not in the sense that we don't perform, but in the sense that we don't make success so important that we have to destroy the other person. We don't try to destroy the other person, nor do we bring personal animosity into the competition. That way, there can be healthy competition.
Very good, Swami. Thank you.
So, this is off track, I mean, slightly.
Thank you.
So, regarding the Bhagavad Gita, so what Krishna tells Arjuna in the Bhagavad Gita is, as I mentioned, that I was talking about the mind misleading people today. And actually, the mind the inner world, which had become turbulent for Arjuna. And the inner world has become turbulent for all of us in different ways. So if we connect ourselves with the spiritual reality through yoga, so I was saying yoga, mantra yoga especially, sound vibration can be like a consciousness elevator. When our consciousness is elevated upwards, we can be concerned without being disturbed. So we can deal with problems without being consumed by them. And bliss is especially important for leaders. Because for a leader, every small decision can be hugely consequential. It can be devastating if some decision turns out to be wrong. And this itself creates a big pressure. So the avenue to release mental pressure is far more important, far more needed for leaders. And that's why we have, Krishna is considered in the tradition to be God. He could have spoken the Bhagavad Gita to anywhere and to anyone. But he speaks it in a demanding setting, and he speaks it as a conversation between leaders to demonstrate the universality of his message. The universality, the necessity, and the urgency of his message. So what the Gita tells us about leadership is that each of us has a spiritual side. And the more we connect with our spiritual side, the more we can bring out the best within us. And we can live in the way that it can bring out the best within others. The Bhagavad Gita, in this sense, has an inside-out approach to leadership. Inside-out means, there is the question is, are leaders born or are leaders made? So there are certain skills of public leadership that everyone may not have. Everyone may not be a great speaker. Everyone may not have charisma. Everyone may not have excellent organizational or delegational skills. These are skills which some people can have, some people may not have. But leadership is not shaped only by these qualities. Leadership is shaped by one's own disposition of wanting to make a contribution. If that inner sense of inner disposition is there, then everyone can act as a leader. So the Bhagavad Gita, by its inside-out approach, it does not focus on public speaking skills, it does not focus on delegation and management. But what focuses on is what we can do internally by which we can make the best use of our outer skills. Our ability to tap our ability is enhanced by our spirituality. Our ability to tap our ability. We have certain abilities, but if we do not have mental stability, if we don't have mental clarity, we will not be able to use our abilities. So our ability to tap our ability is enhanced by our spirituality. And I'll conclude with one example of how this can happen. Most of us
we live such a fast-paced, stressful life that we all inevitably face anxiety, worry, whatever we call it. Now, worry is something very peculiar in the sense that actually it consumes a lot of energy while staying invisible. Now, we never put in our schedule, okay, 7 to 7:30 worry time. Nobody does that. But worry is a constant background noise which distracts us, it sucks our energy. Now, definitely there are worrying situations in life. And sometimes if people don't take attention, pay attention to those situations, sometimes children are playing and children fearlessly run towards the fire. And seeing that may make their mother fearful. A child is fearless, the mother becomes fearful. There are situations when we should worry. That means we should be responsible and concerned. But when worry consumes us, then it saps our ability to deal with external situations. So worry is caused not so much by external uncertainty. Although that is what often we think is the trigger of worry. Oh, this goes wrong, this meeting doesn't work out, we can't meet this deadline, if this person doesn't do this, what will happen? So we often think that the external uncertainty is the cause of worry. And this is true to some extent. But anxiety has been studied by researchers all over the world, and especially because the World Health Organization has recognized that in this century, mental health problems are going to be the biggest health challenge. So an intriguing pattern has been